On this Tuesday night, Ontario ends inoculation interruptions. The apologies for a holiday break.
We will not take any more days off until we win this war against COVID-19.
Plus, the proposal to do what no one else is doing. Desperate families and demands for better care.
Save our seniors now!
Pleas to protect our most vulnerable from the virus. Boeing 737 MAX returns to American airspace. The families who want to see the fleet grounded for good. And major earthquake. Yeah! Chaos in Croatia.
Global National with Donna Friesen. Reporting tonight, Farah Nasser.
Good evening. I hope you and your family are doing well tonight. With New Year's Eve just a couple days away, there's a stark reminder not to let your guard down with COVID-19. Canada's two largest provinces are now battling the virus like never before. Ontario reported a staggering 2,553 cases, a single-day high. Quebec also marked a new record with 2,381 infections. And the province has confirmed its first case of the more contagious variant of COVID-19, the fourth province to do so behind Ontario, Alberta, and BC. Pressure is growing to get Canadians vaccinated as soon as possible after several provinces, like Ontario, were criticized for scaling back immunizations over the holidays. Clinics in all provinces are now open. And Ontario expects to get its first doses of the Moderna vaccine tomorrow. But as Richard Zussman reports, there's still lots of work to do.
Holiday break over. After days of being criticized for closing COVID-19 vaccine clinics in Ontario, the person in charge of distribution apologizing.
It was the wrong decision. I think I acknowledge that quite clearly and accept the responsibility that we'll get better faster now, because we've learned from that and we've heard the voices of the people of Ontario saying, get on with this.
Former General Rick Hillier announcing Ontario will now be fast-tracking COVID vaccinations and asking the federal government to consider providing the Moderna vaccine as a single dose instead of two, something not done in any other jurisdiction in the world.
I haven't seen evidence that says one shot can work. What I'd like is somebody to look at it, come back and tell us, no, it's not possible, or come back and say, yes, we can do it, and here's what we're going to do.
The federal government says Moderna would need to prove the one shot is effective in order to support a change. It currently requires two doses administered 28 days apart. The Moderna vaccine is now being distributed in Canada, arriving in the Northwest Territories and Yukon on Monday. Vaccination set to begin there in January.
We can start building that, asking Health Canada, asking Moderna, what's the longest interval we can go between the two doses? I think we can certainly consider when that second dose needs to be, if it's day 28 for Moderna, or can we wait, 6 weeks or 8 weeks?
Across the country, doses are slow to roll out. Every jurisdiction with fewer than 10,000 shots except Ontario and Quebec. Many regions running reduced immunization clinic hours over the past week, including Manitoba, British Columbia, and Ontario. Compare Canada, with a vaccination rate of 0.16 per 100 people, to the United States, where four times as many people are getting the shot per capita, with a rate of 0.64 per 100 people being vaccinated.
So the term falling behind is laden with all sorts of emotions. I think what I would say is we could definitely be doing better.
Every province and territory has different priorities in terms of who's getting the shot first, but the common goal is to give the vaccination to those that are most vulnerable before the general public. The stated goal from the federal government still to inoculate everyone in Canada who wants it by the fall of 2021. Richard Zussman, Global News, Victoria.
While health officials urged people to stay home for the holidays, Ontario's finance minister didn't. Rod Phillips and his wife left Canada on vacation on December 13th. It's not clear where he is or when he's coming back. He said the getaway was previously planned, adding if he knew the province would eventually shut down, he would have canceled the trip. The federal government tweeted a reminder today advising against non-essential travel, noting there are severe penalties for returning travelers who don't abide by the mandatory 14-day quarantine. Phillips says he will, but Ontario's premier says he wants Phillips back in Canada now. Tonight, Doug Ford says he's extremely disappointed in Phillips and calls the trip unacceptable. Once again, in this second wave, our elderly are dealing with this dangerous outbreak at long-term care homes all over Canada. In Ontario, at one home, the death toll keeps climbing. At least 48 people have died. Friends and family gathered outside there today. Morgan Campbell has been following the latest developments. Morgan, what's their message?
We are talking about dozens of deaths during the Christmas break alone. It has caused family members and advocacy groups to call for government accountability and military intervention. It is intervention that they want to see right now.
Save our seniors now!
You are looking at more than 40 candles to honor those taken by COVID-19 at this long-term care home east of Toronto.
You can see the fear and anguish in the eyes of those protesting outside of Tender Care Living Center as the number of COVID-positive residents continues to mount.
My greatest fear is that my grandmother is going to die without dignity, and she's left alone and scared and feeling like we weren't there for her.
Jessica Wong's grandmother is one of more than 100 residents diagnosed with the novel coronavirus. So has Brenda Tam's mother, Moon. She cringes every time Tender Care shows up on her caller ID.
I'm scared they tell you, like, your mom getting worse or something bad news.
North York General Hospital took over the management of the outbreak on Christmas Day. The home continues to maintain infection prevention and control education is well underway. During a news conference at Queen's Park, our request for information went unanswered.
Thanks, everyone.
The Ford government has received backlash from families and advocacy groups for not addressing the deaths during the holiday season.
We've lost our priorities at this point of the game. This is not acceptable.
Although grim, there is a silver lining. Families say they are finding strength in numbers as they forge through these uncertain times.
You know, being there for each other and empowering each other.
There are concerns that basic care needs are not being met, but family members have been shut out of the home and are unable to verify. Meanwhile, the home is conducting a hiring blitz in an effort to replenish a depleting staffing level. Morgan Campbell, Global News.
To the U.S. now, which has recorded its first case of the new coronavirus variant. The country's vaccine rollout is also hitting some major snags. The Trump administration had promised 20 million Americans would be vaccinated by the end of the year, but only 2 million people have rolled up their sleeves. As Jackson Proskow reports, incoming President Joe Biden faces a monumental task to get the job done.
Let's do it.
Despite more high-profile vaccinations, like Vice President-elect Kamala Harris,
so I urge everyone, when it is your turn, get vaccinated.
The U.S. has so far failed to deliver on promises of widespread rapid vaccine rollout, a problem President-elect Joe Biden is set to inherit in less than a month.
The Trump administration's plan to distribute vaccines is falling behind, far behind.
Biden has promised to deliver 100 million doses in his first 100 days in office and vowed to use the Defense Production Act to ramp up vaccine production.
I'm going to move heaven and earth to get us going in the right direction.
Just a few weeks ago, the Trump administration made its own big promises.
20 million Americans could be vaccinated just before the end of this month in December.
To date, little more than 2 million Americans have been vaccinated, even though more than 11 million doses have been sent to various locations around the country. Shots simply aren't going into arms fast enough.
Once they made these arrangements and deals with the manufacturers, they basically kind of did a little bit of a hands-off approach in terms of how then states would choose to prioritize people, distribute the vaccines, and honestly deal with problems.
Experts say the U.S. needs to turn the current rate of 1 million vaccinations per week into 3.5 million vaccinations per day to reach herd immunity by the summer.
I'm worried about overpromising on when things are going to be able to be back to normal. You have to build in that there are going to be hitches in this process.
Still, a vaccine will eventually deliver a way forward, even if delivering the vaccine takes longer than expected. Jackson Proskow, Global News, Washington.
Back in the U.S. after a ban. Coming up, the push to stop the Boeing 737 MAX from flying here in Canada. Canadian Senator Elaine McCoy has passed away at 74 years old. Her start in politics began in Alberta. The McCoy was born in Brandon, Manitoba. A lawyer who once served as a Calgary MLA, the former Alberta cabinet minister, was named to the Senate in 2005. She served as an independent voice for Canadians and was the first senator to blog about her experiences in Ottawa. Boeing's troubled 737 MAX 8 is back in the air, resuming passenger flights in the United States. The aircraft was grounded worldwide. That was following two deadly crashes that killed a total of 346 people, including 18 Canadians. As Ross Lord reports, Canada could soon follow suit, despite the objections of victims' families.
Reintroducing the 737 MAX to the flying public could be difficult. After all, the pandemic has stifled air travel, and polling suggests people are extra nervous about flying in this plane. It's no wonder. Before the 737 MAX was grounded, it was involved in a pair of crashes that killed 346 people. But Boeing and its airline partners insist the plane is now safe to fly.
Fortunately, this aircraft has been checked out from top to bottom, and we're confident that it's ready to go.
A statement from Boeing says the company has learned many hard lessons from the mass casualty crashes, lessons that further focused our attention on our core values of safety, quality, and integrity. There's no mention of another priority, profit. A congressional committee said Boeing put cost-cutting ahead of safety updates to flight control software that was flawed, software linked to both fatal crashes.
While the aircraft has been down for 20 months, they've actually gone through and put out a number of different airworthiness directives. So the wire bundle separation is actual physical changes that's been done to the wire bundle inside of the aircraft itself.
24-year-old Danielle Moore was one of 18 Canadians killed in the Ethiopian Airlines crash. Her father, like most of the victims' families, opposes the plane's return.
Well, the best possible outcome, I think, is for Boeing to come to their senses and say, you know what, we can't continue with a charade. We're going to pull the plug on the MAX. It's not going to happen.
The MAX is still grounded in Canada, though just this month, Transport Canada approved design changes to the aircraft, bringing it one step closer to flying again in Canadian skies. Ross Lord, Global News.
Ahead, the desperate search for survivors in Croatia after a second powerful earthquake. A second powerful earthquake in 2 days has rattled Croatia. The magnitude 6.4 earthquake killed at least seven people and left a trail of destruction southeast of Zagreb. A desperate search is underway now for survivors. Now back to COVID-19. In the United Kingdom, where case numbers are surging, the second round of Pfizer-BioNTech vaccinations is now officially underway. But as Redmond Shannon reports, many countries are nowhere near that.
Ireland's first COVID-19 shot. The latest European Union country to begin a vaccination program. The EU is playing catch-up with its departing member, the UK, where vaccinations began 3 weeks ago. Worldwide, the US is way out in front with more than 2 million doses administered. Canada is in fifth place with just under 60,000 shots. But per capita, Israel is streets ahead of everyone else with more than 5% of the population vaccinated. Israel's early success in quickly hitting 500,000 is perfect timing for Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu as he prepares for yet another election. He called Israel the world champion of vaccinations, coming after a year that has hit the country's economy hard.
We have a secret weapon. We're a small country.
Professor Jonathan Gershoni says Israel's efficient healthcare network helps too, but he highlights an issue that many countries will soon face.
I'm a bit worried about where we're going to be once we've exhausted the enthusiastic sector of our population and we start to have to systematically convince those that are vaccine hesitant.
Israel, of course, is relatively rich, but poorer nations will struggle to manage vaccines that need to be stored at minus 70 degrees. That's where the AstraZeneca vaccine could make a difference, reportedly ready for UK approval this week.
It's really been developed in order to be able to produce a vaccine at a very low cost that can be rolled out worldwide.
Countries like Iran, meanwhile, face a different challenge.
Aloha.
It has begun early trials of its own vaccine, its hand partly forced by US trade sanctions. Redmond Shannon, Global News, London.
Next, how science stepped up in 2020 to face a global threat. Edmonton soccer star Alphonso Davies has been named the Canadian Press Male Athlete of the Year. Davies, who was born in a refugee camp in Ghana, had an outstanding year, winning the UEFA Champions League at the age of 19. At this time last year, doctors in China were treating dozens of patients with an unknown pneumonia. It's hard to fathom that COVID-19 was first named in the same year a vaccine was developed for the deadly virus. Eric Sorensen explains how the pandemic paved the way for historic breakthroughs in medical science.
When Chinese television announced the first death from an unknown virus last January, the seafood market in Wuhan was already shut down. Critics say authorities were not transparent as patient numbers grew. But at that very moment, Chinese researchers shared online with the world something they just discovered, the genetic sequence of the virus. Immediately, an army of scientists across the globe put aside other work and zeroed in on this one virus.
The sharing of expertise and experiences from China is very important. So the genetic sequence was critical in all of this. It allowed us to identify the nature of the virus very, very quickly. So we knew it was a coronavirus.
With this novel coronavirus genetically understood, some scientists used snippets of messenger RNA to tell cells to build spike proteins like the ones on the virus itself. The vaccine was tested on volunteers, infecting them with the proteins. That triggered the immune system to create antibodies and T cells to attack them. And the immune response would then be ready to pounce when the real virus shows up. It was simple and, experts believed, safe.
Not flinch at all.
We never touch the virus. We make the protein. We can make it very pure. And we can inject that and have an immune response to the spike protein that will be protective.
By spring, the virus was now spreading far beyond China, described in Europe as the worst health crisis in a century. Then North America was hit.
We are now the epicenter of this crisis.
In Canada, COVID-19 arrived unseen and deadly. The country locked down.
We all need to act now. COVID-19 is a serious public health threat.
Quietly, though, in nondescript buildings around the world, from Beijing to New York, in spotless laboratories in India and in Germany, various vaccines were being developed, an international effort more cooperative than competitive.
All the vaccine manufacturers are working together, and we're all in a race to battle the disease. There's no one-upmanship here.
Labs worked flat out. Money was no object because governments put up whatever was needed.
We have collectively pledged 7.4 billion euros for vaccines, diagnostics, and treatments.
Advancements were happening with unprecedented speed because so many people were available for vaccine trials and so many tested positive.
The duration of the trial is determined by how quickly you can get people testing positive for the disease. So this compressed what would have been years of data collection into weeks. It changed everything.
By summer, COVID-19 appeared to be easing up, and the vaccine still seemed very far away. But the Canadian government was securing doses by the millions from Pfizer, Moderna, Johnson & Johnson, and others. Contracts for more vaccines per capita than any country in the world.
We're making sure that if one of these potential vaccines is successful, Canada and Canadians will have access to the doses they need.
The importance of those decisions would become apparent later, as a new wave of COVID-19 swept in with the autumn weather.
Our world has reached an agonizing milestone, the loss of 1 million lives from the COVID-19 pandemic.
COVID cases and hospitalizations surged and lockdowns returned. But the swiftness of the science, the funding, the trials, the vaccine production, and the global partnerships were all about to pay off.
We have a vaccine for the world.
More than one manufacturer delivered startling results.
It is a great day for science. It is a great day for humanity when you realize that your vaccine has a 90% effectiveness. That's overwhelming.
Like a December gift, the first approved vaccines from Pfizer-BioNTech were delivered. And Canadians were among the first in the world to start getting shots, a turning point in a terrible year.
It's going to give us back our families, our communities, our lives, our loved ones. And it's going to save people that we would otherwise have lost.
Vaccine development typically takes 4 years and in many cases much longer. COVID-19 took less than 1 year.
The speed is the result of a singular focus of the entirety of civilization on one problem. So I can't imagine this happening at any other point in prior human history for a number of technological and global cooperation reasons. This is one of the most magical moments in public health history.
Canada's large contracts not only bode well for vaccinating Canadians, the World Health Organization singled out this country for its commitment to share millions of excess doses through COVAX, so developing countries will not be left out.
I would like to thank Canada and Prime Minister Trudeau for committing to share surplus doses of COVID-19 vaccines.
Immunizations will take time, and the virus will still make this winter dispiriting and deadly. But one crowning accomplishment will come from 2020. Vaccines, enough for the world, have begun.
It is emotional. It's the beginning of the end.
Eric Sorensen, Global News, Toronto.
And that's Global National for this Tuesday night. I'm Farah Nasser. Tonight, your Canada is the sunrise over Calgary. Thank you so much for watching. Until tomorrow, take care of yourselves and each other. Have a great night.